Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord.
Peace in heaven and glory in the highest.
Let us pray. Assist us mercifully with your help, O Lord, God of our salvation, that we may enter with joy upon the contemplation of those mighty acts whereby you have given us life and immortality through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen. Amen. The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
After telling a parable to the crowd at Jericho, Jesus went on ahead, going up to Jerusalem. When he had come near Bethpage and Bethany, at the place called Mount of Olives, he sent two of the disciples, saying, "Go into the village ahead of you, and as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt who's never been ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you why you're untying it, just say this, 'The Lord needs it.' So those who were sent departed and found it as he had told them. As they were untying the colt, its owners asked them, 'Why are you untying the colt?' And they said, 'The Lord needs it.' Then they brought it to Jesus. And after throwing their cloaks on the colt, they set Jesus on it. As he rode along, people kept spreading their cloaks on the road. As he was now approaching the path down from the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of the disciples began to praise God joyfully with a loud voice for all the deeds of power that they had seen, saying, "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest heaven." Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to him, "Teacher, order your disciples to stop." He answered, "I tell you, if these were silent, the stones would shout out." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ. The Lord be with you. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is right to praise you, Almighty God, for the acts of love by which you have redeemed us through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. On this day, he entered the holy city of Jerusalem in triumph and was proclaimed as King of Kings by those who spread their garments and branches of palm along the way. Let these branches be for us signs of his victory, and grant that we who bear them in his name may ever hail him as our King and follow him in the way that leads to eternal life, who lives and reigns in glory with you and the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna in the highest.
Let us go forth in peace.
In the name of Christ, amen. Amen.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna, hey, zana, 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 hosanna, hey, zana, hosanna.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna in the highest.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, whose most dear Son went up not to joy, but first he suffered pain, and entered not into glory before he was crucified, mercifully grant that we, walking in the way of the cross, may find it none other than the way of life and peace, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, in your tender love for the human race, you sent your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, to take upon him our nature and to suffer death upon the cross, giving us the example of his great humility. Mercifully grant that we may walk in the way of his suffering, and also share in his resurrection. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen. Amen.
A reading from the book of Isaiah. The Lord God has given me the tongue of a teacher, that I may know how to sustain the weary with a word. Morning by morning he wakens my ear to listen as those who are taught. The Lord God has opened my ear, and I was not rebellious. I did not turn backward. I gave my back to those who struck me, and my cheeks to those who pulled out the beard. I did not hide my face from insult and spitting. The Lord God helps me. Therefore, I have not been disgraced. Therefore, I have set my face like flint, and I know that I shall not be put to shame. He who vindicates me is near. Who will contend with me? Let us stand up together. Who are my adversaries? Let them confront me. It is the Lord God who helps me. Who will declare me guilty? The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We'll say in unison Psalm 31, verses 9 through 16. Have mercy on me, O Lord, for I am in trouble. My eye is consumed with sorrow, and also my throat and my belly. For my life is wasted with grief, and my years with sighing. My strength fails me because of affliction, and my bones are consumed. I have become a reproach to all my enemies and even to my neighbors, a dismay to those of my acquaintance. When they see me in the street, they avoid me. I am forgotten like a dead man, out of mind. I am as useless as a broken pot, for I have heard the whispering of the crowd. Fear is all around. They put their heads together against me. They plot to take my life. But as for me, I have trusted in you, O Lord. I have said, you are my God. My times are in your hand. Rescue me from the hand of my enemies and from those who persecute me. Make your face to shine upon your servant, and in your loving kindness save me.
A reading from the letter of Paul to the Philippians. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness. And being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bend in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Saint Matthew. Now Jesus stood before the governor, and the governor asked him,
"Are you the King of the Jews?"
Jesus said,
"You say so."
But when he was accused by the chief priests and elders, he did not answer them. Then Pilate said to him,
"Do you not hear how many accusations they make against you?"
But he gave him no answer, not even to a single charge, so that the governor was greatly amazed. Now, at the festival, the governor was accustomed to release a prisoner for the crowd, anyone whom they wanted. At that time, they had a notorious prisoner called Jesus Barabbas. So, after they had gathered, Pilate said to them,
"Whom do you want me to release for you, Jesus Barabbas or Jesus who is called the Messiah?"
For he realized that it was out of jealousy that they had handed him over. While he was sitting on the judgment seat, his wife sent word to him,
"Have nothing to do with that innocent man, for today I have suffered a great deal because of a dream about him."
Now the chief priests and the elders persuaded the crowds to ask for Barabbas and to have Jesus killed. The governor again said to them,
"Which of the two do you want me to release for you?"
And they said,
"Barabbas."
Pilate said to them,
"Then what should I do with Jesus who is called the Messiah?"
All of them said,
"Let him be crucified."
Then he asked,
"When? What evil has he done?"
But they shouted all the more,
"Let him be crucified."
So when Pilate saw that he could do nothing, but rather that a riot was beginning, he took some water and washed his hands before the crowd, saying,
"I am innocent of this man's blood. See to it yourselves."
Then the people as a whole answered,
"His blood be on us and on our children."
So he released Barabbas for them, and after flogging Jesus, he handed him over to be crucified. Then the soldiers of the governor took Jesus into the governor's headquarters, and they gathered the whole cohort around him. They stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him. And after twisting some thorns into a crown, they put it on his head. They put a reed in his right hand and knelt before him and mocked him, saying,
"Hail, King of the Jews!"
They spat on him and took the reed and struck him on the head. After mocking him, they stripped him of the robe and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him away to crucify him. As they went out, they came upon a man from Cyrene called Simon. They compelled this man to carry his cross. And when they came to a place called Golgotha, which means place of a skull, they offered him wine and drink, mixed with gall. But when he tasted it, he could not drink it. And when they had crucified him, they divided his clothes among themselves by casting lots. Then they sat down there and kept watch over him. Over his head, they put the charge against him, which read, "This is Jesus, the King of the Jews." Then two bandits were crucified with him, one on his right and one on his left. Those who passed by derided him, shaking their heads and saying,
"You who would destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself. If you are the Son of God, come down from the cross."
In the same way, the chief priests also, along with the scribes and elders, were mocking him, saying,
"He saved others? He cannot save himself. He is the King of Israel? Let him come down now from the cross, and we will believe in him. He trusts in God. Let God deliver him now, if he wants to. For he said, 'I am God's son.'"
The bandits who were crucified with him also taunted him in the same way. From noon on, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. And about 3:00, Jesus cried with a loud voice,
"Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani."
That is,
my God, why have you forsaken me?"
When some of the bystanders heard it, they said,
"This man is calling for Elijah."
At once, one of them ran and got a sponge, filled it with sour wine, put it on a stick, and gave it to him to drink. But the other said,
"Wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to save him."
Then Jesus cried again with a loud voice and breathed his last. At that moment, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook and the rocks were split. The tombs were also opened, and many bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep were raised. After his resurrection, they came out of the tombs and entered the holy city and appeared to many. Now when the centurion and those with him, who were keeping watch over Jesus, saw the earthquake and what took place, they were terrified and said,
"Truly, this man was God's son."
Many women were also there, looking on from a distance. They had followed Jesus from Galilee and had provided for him. Among them were Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James and Joseph, and the mother of the sons of Zebedee. When it was evening, there came a rich man from Arimathea, called Joseph, who was also a disciple of Jesus. He went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then Pilate ordered it to be given to him. So Joseph took the body and wrapped it in a clean linen cloth and laid it in his own new tomb, which he had hewn in the rock. He then rolled a great stone to the door of the tomb and went away. Mary Magdalene and the other Mary were there, sitting opposite the tomb. The next day, that is after the day of preparation, the chief priests and the Pharisees gathered before Pilate and said,
"Sir, we remember what that impostor said while he was still alive. After 3 days, I will rise again. Therefore, command the tomb to be made secure until the third day. Otherwise, his disciples may go and steal him away and tell the people, 'He has been raised from the dead.' And the last deception would be worse than the first."
Pilate said to them,
"You have a guard of soldiers. Go, make it as secure as you can."
So they went with the guard and made the tomb secure by sealing the stone.
May the words of my mouth and the meditations of each heart be always acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. In Palm Sunday and Passion Sunday, we see two dramas enacted on the same day, even during the same liturgy, all in a little over an hour. The Gospels tell us that Jesus enters the city of Jerusalem humbly riding a donkey, and he is greeted by a large crowd who has prepared his way with branches cut from trees. Tradition has it that these are palm branches, which makes sense as the palm was a symbol of Roman victory. The palm branch was a symbol of achievement and triumph. So this parade into Jerusalem is a triumphal entry. Jesus makes his triumphal entry into Jerusalem with palm branches waving. Again, signs of victory. And then we live into this sudden reversal expressed in the reading of the Passion, moving from the Garden of Gethsemane to Pilate, to Herod, to the cross at Golgotha, to the tomb. And of course, that's where today's story ends, at the tomb. We move from the parade to crucifixion as Jesus moves from celebrity status to a criminal guilty of blasphemy and treason, soon to be just another forgotten criminal. We start today with the procession, the parade, the triumphal entry. Typically, we process with palm branches waving, even wearing palm branches folded into the shape of a cross. This year, we've more likely picked up palm branches at the church parking lot than in the narthex of the church. and our parade has more likely been in motor vehicles than following on foot behind a cross. But it remains Palm Sunday. You may or may not know this, but it is tradition that we take these palms after Palm Sunday and we save them. And then sometime before the next Ash Wednesday, we burn them. And the ashes we use to mark our foreheads on Ash Wednesday, when we say, "Remember you are dust, and to dust you shall return," these ashes are those burned palms. The symbol for triumph becomes the symbol for our mortality. We move from the parade to the cross. Symbols are like that. Look at the cross itself. The cross was an instrument of execution, no different than a guillotine or an electric chair or a gas chamber, an instrument of execution. And now we wear this cross, a powerful symbol which claims that God was on that very cross at Golgotha, that God was on that cross. I don't know about you, but the cross is the only way I can make sense out of life sometimes. When someone challenges the existence of God, or the goodness of God, or evidence of God because of all the evil in the world, or because of natural disasters, or because of plagues, or illnesses, or untimely deaths, when we are challenged with that question, how could a God, if a God exists, allow bad things to happen, really bad things? It's fine to sit around the coffee table or the classroom and talk about free will and speculate on other theological answers. And that's important to do. It's important to struggle with that, and I encourage such theological exploration and study. But when all those questions move from the theoretical to a moment of grief or pain or struggle or doubt, those answers are kind of lame for me. Sometimes only the cross makes sense to me, for God was on that cross. God was in the concentration camps. God was in the Twin Towers. God was in the gas chamber. God was in those children's classrooms. God is in those hospitals with all those who are suffering and dying, as well as all those doctors and nurses as they risk their lives fighting this virus. When we wear the cross, we are claiming that God was on that cross at Golgotha. We are claiming where God was and where God goes and where God is, because God goes where there is suffering and grief and death, even to the tomb. It's safe to say that there are suffering people wondering where God is in the midst of this novel coronavirus crisis. This virus has taken lives. It has taken away jobs and livelihoods. This crisis has changed, at least for a moment in history, our way of life. It has changed our way of being the church, changed our way of being together, changed the way we communicate, changed the way we participate in liturgies, even during Holy Week. Our clergy have been gathering by Zoom frequently, partly to check in pastorally with one another, partly to make some decisions together in our rapidly changing context. Our conversations have ranged from the profound to the practical. One priest, and I don't remember who, one priest asked a question, a practical question, about the reserve sacrament, the consecrated bread and wine kept on reserve to take to the homebound or the hospitalized. It's customary to consume the wine on Maundy Thursday or after the Mass of the pre-sanctified on Good Friday. With physical distancing, we won't have the usual gathering to consume the consecrated wine, so the priest, The priest wondered aloud if there was something we should do differently this year. The normal practice is to consume it, or to pour it into the ground, or to pour it into a special sink in the sacristy called a piscina. It was decided that our circumstances don't really change our practice in this case, but I want to say something about the piscina, and I'm going somewhere with this. Anytime a priest has blessed too much wine, more wine than we need to keep on reserve, we pour that consecrated wine into this special sink, this piscina, because it drains straight into the ground rather than into the sewer system. We treat the consecrated bread and wine with reverence. We don't pour the body and blood of Christ into the sewer, but rather into the earth. Now, I'm not suggesting we should do it any other way. I'm not suggesting that we should be anything less than reverent with the body and blood of Christ. And yet I have wondered what we are saying. For surely we are not suggesting that there is some place that Christ does not go, or should not be, or should not see. Surely we're not suggesting that any place on earth, any sewer, any tomb, is beyond or beneath the reach of Christ. After all, every time we proclaim the Apostles' Creed or recite the baptismal covenant, we say, "He descended to the dead," or "He descended into hell." As tradition has it, and this comes from St. Peter, Christ descended to the dead to proclaim the good news of forgiveness and release to the captives. Good news to those who thought they were beyond redemption, beyond God's reach, beyond God's grace, beyond and beneath God's love. In the Eastern Orthodox portrayal of the resurrection, their icons reveal Christ in his glory, trampling down the broken doors of hell. And in one hand, Jesus pulls up Adam out of the darkness, and with the other hand, he pulls up Eve. Adam and Eve and all of humankind are raised with Christ. No place is beyond or beneath his reach. No one is beyond or beneath his grace and love. No sewer, no hell, no tomb is beyond or beneath God's love. The tomb is not the last word. Those ashes from Ash Wednesday are not the last word. God breathes life into dust. That's our story. God breathes life into those ashes. And we proclaim it on Palm Sunday as we wear the symbol of victory, the palm cross, or any cross, a sign of God's triumph.
I ask your prayers for God's people throughout the world, for our bishops, Scott, Sam, and Rayford, for this gathering, and for all ministers and people. Pray for the church. I ask your prayers for peace, for goodwill among nations, and for the well-being of all people. Pray for justice and peace. I ask your prayers for the poor, the sick, the hungry, the oppressed, and those in prison. Pray for those in any need or trouble. I ask your prayers for all who seek God or a deeper knowledge of God. Pray that they may find and be found by him. I ask your prayers for the departed. Pray for those who have died. Praise God for those in every generation in whom Christ has been honored. Pray that we may have grace to glorify Christ in our own day.
Lord Jesus Christ, on this day you receive the worship of those who hailed you as their King. Accept our praise and adoration, our worship and love, and grant that we who now confess you with our lips may never fail to give you the service of our lives. For the honor of your holy name, for you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, world without end. Amen.
Amen.